Good afternoon, students. So today we are going to talk about the topic fungi, zygomycosis, eucormycosis. We are going to learn in a small group discussion. So for today's topic, the learning objectives are that you should be able to understand which are the agents of zygomycosis and which is now currently known as eucormycosis. You should be able to understand the common causative agents of zygomycosis and should be able to understand the pathogenesis of this disease caused by various species of zygomycetes, the clinical features of zygomycosis, which includes rhinocerebral zygomycosis, pulmonary zygomycosis, cutaneous zygomycosis, gastrointestinal zygomycosis, disseminated zygomycosis, and the laboratory diagnosis and treatment part of this particular disease, zygomycosis. So we'll start with this zygomycosis or eucormycosis. It is an acute or chronic infection caused by several primitive fungal agents belonging to the phylum Zygomycota. These are saprophobic fungi, are fairly common, and they are ubiquitous and found in the environment. They are traditionally considered as non-pathogenic for humans and animals, usually treated as fungal contaminant in diagnostic microbiological approaches. But due to their opportunistic nature, these may be pathogenic to humans depending upon underlying predisposing factors, the tissues, the tissue form of these eucormycosis or zygomycosis causing agents are broad accepted hyphae with predilection for invading the vessels of the arterial system, causing embolization and subsequently causing necrosis of the surrounding tissue. Since the tissue forms of these organisms are indistinguishable in histopathological section, hence fungal cultures are essential for speciation. Clinical course of the disease differs according to the site involved and quality of the species. The zygomycosis is an umbrella term used for the diseases caused by many insects. Accepted filamentous fungal species classified under the order Eucorales, Entomophthalans of the class Zygomycetes, under the phylum Zygomycetes. Some investigators prefer to call mycosis caused by members belonging to the order Eucorales as eucormycosis and to the order Entomophthalans as entomophthalomycosis mycosis or subcutaneous zygomycosis. It is further subdivided into two types, canidioplomomycosis, conidioplomomycosis, and presidioplomomycosis. Okay. So, as there are fungi in the same class of zygomycosis, which produce symptoms quite different from those by the members of other eucorales, and thus some workers prefer more restrictive distinction, designation for eucormycosis as appropriate term. But due to changes in taxonomy and extent of range of etiological agents, designation zygomycosis should be preferred over the older and still frequently used term eucormycosis. So to start with history, Kretschmeister, Frederick Kretschmeister is the first one who described the case of zygomycosis in a patient of neoplastic lung on the basis of his histology, which was probably the first authentic case of human mycosis. Human eucormycosis. Furbringer in 1876 first described pulmonary eucormycosis caused by Absidia. At the time, most of the pathogenic zygomycosis my cells were originally classified as a member of genus Rupert. These organisms will later be assigned different genera and families within order Eucorals. In 1884, Lithin established pathogenicity of Eucorals and Crabbits and described two species, Mucor, now Absidia, Corymbia, and Mucor, now Rhizopus, Rhizopus. So this is the investigation done by Fabringer in 1876. The first case of pulmonary mucor mycosis caused by the abscess. In 1885, Plotkin coined the term mycosis mucorana and described first a well-documented case of systemic infection with the gastric and rhinocerebral involvement, which was known as mucor mycosis. So, we will see the structural details of zygomycetes. Zygomycete is a group of oophongi and their hyphae are generally non-separate. So, you can see here in the picture, these are non-separate hypha. They are non-septate or sparsely septate. Okay. These members, they reproduce asexually by the way of sporangiospores formed within the sac called as sporangium. You can see here. This is the sporangium and the spores which are released here. These are the sporangiospores. And these are held by the means of conidial development. The fungi also reproduce sexually by formation of single dark thick wood spore called as zygospore. You can see here, this is a single dark thick wood spore called as zygospore. Okay, that is sexual reproduction, and this is asexual reproduction by the formation of spore. On the basis of zygospore formation, these fungi classified under the phylum Zygomycete. Okay, understand? This is gametogenia, that is sexual reproduction by gametogenia plus and minus strains in the mix, and they produce zygospore, which is a thick walled black protein spore produced by the process of meiosis, and this is a sexual reproduction process by the asexual reproduction process where they form the sporangiophore polymela, and then the sporangiophore that contain the has the sporangium which is filled with the sporangiospores, and these spores are released, and then again they form these structures of zygomycetes. They are called as, that is the process of asexual reproduction. So on basis of zygospore formation, fungi classified under the phylum Zygomycota, divided into the classes Trichomycetes and Zygomycetes. Agents of zygomycosis are fall into orders Mucorales and Entomopterales. Okay, so zygomycetes are composed of non-septate or sparsely septate hyphae. These are non-septate or sparsely septate hyphae. The nature of spores bearing structure, location of rhizoids, type of zygospores produced, and physiological characteristics are usually used to differentiate genera and species in the mycology laboratory. In addition, length and ramification of sporangiopore, diameter of sporangium, presence and form of apophysis and shape of columella are also used for the identification of some species like Cocheromyces. Dimorphic conversion to yeast cell is observed in Cunninghamla. So, geological agents in approximate order of their frequency as pathogens are listed as mucorals, which are responsible for causing mucormycosis, like rhizopus arisus, rhizopus mucosporus, or rhizopodiformis, mucor rhizomosis, absilia cornifimia, like currently known as lithicinia. So, in number of the succinia, vasiformis, these are there. To study with the order mucorals, fungal species belong to the order mucorals. These are ubiquitous in environment, found in food, soil, and air, frequently encountered in laboratories as lab contaminants. The relevance of isolates in clinical material may be difficult to establish. If cyanocytic hyperelements are not seen in direct examination of KOH, that is potassium hydroxide rate, or histopathological section, hence repeated isolation of the organism from consecutive clinical specimens that provides a strong evidence that organism may be relevant, though cyanocytic hyperelements are not seen and are rarely seen in histopathological examination of tissue. An important point to note that all fungi which are cyanocytic hyphae are classified as zygomycetes, but all zygomycetes are not having the cyanocytic hyphae. So we have just seen order mucorals has rhizopus, mucor rhizomosis, mucor rhizomucorphyllis, fusilis, lechithimina, corymbifera, previously known as absilia corymbifera, Apophysomyces elegans, and another order Entomopterans, responsible for causing entomopteromycosis, contains Basidiobulus ranus, Ranarum, Conidiobulus coronotus. Morphological features of mucorals. So first start with mucor. Mucor is characterized by its rapidly growing character. They produce light, dull to gray colonies on several textures. Microscopically, there is no presence of rhizomes. And we see under microscope, usually they don't have rhizomes here. And there is no distinct columella also present. So you can see in the diagram that non-septate hyphae with branch sporangial spores, with columella and sporangium. This is the characteristic of mucor: sporangial spores, sporangium, pharyngeal pore, or aerial hyphae, the prostate hyphae, the columella. This is the characteristic growth, which is dull light to gray color. Next is rhizopus. Rhizopus has rhizomes, you can see here, which are directly beneath the sporangial pore. You can see this is the sporangial pore and directly beneath this sporangial pore. Columella is ovoid. You can see here, this is the columella, which is ovoid. And sporangium has the sporangial spores. Okay. Now we can see in the diagram that non-septate hyphae, these are non-septate hyphae, which are present with the rhizoids directly beneath the sporangium pores and the sporangium rhizopus species. Next is lechithimia or absilia. The rhizoids are present at nodes but not directly beneath the sporangium. Okay, you can see here they are present at the nodes but not directly beneath the sporangium pore, as we have seen here in the rhizoids. Sporangial spores are spherical. You can see sporangial spores are spherical, ovoid in nature. Columella is pear-shaped. So these are the differentiating features. What are the differentiating features? Non-septate hyphae is present with rhizoids, which are not directly beneath the sporangial pore like in rhizopus, and they have the sporangia they do have the stolon. This is the characteristic presence of stolon in the Absidia or Lichithymia. Epidemiology. All clinical forms of zygomycosis occurred following infection by causative fungi, which found as saprobes in the environment and on wide range substrate, including soil. The spores of zygomycosis are widely distributed on leaf, leader, and other decaying substances. The spores are not as abundant in free air as seen in Cladosporium or Ultramaria, but they can be found in large number in damp interiors and around the composing vegetation, even present as frayed molds appearing as gray, as grayish, fluffy, and rapidly spreading growth because of their rapid growth and prolific spore forming capacity. Inhalation of conidia is a routine experience. Virulence of these fungi are clearly of low order, and sporadic infections occur throughout the world, particularly in severely debilitated patients. Being an opportunistic infection, zygomycosis is produced by contaminating fungi in the host whose immunological defense mechanisms are weakened by endogenous causes like malignancy, leukemia, diabetes mellitus, or exogenous causes like immunosuppressive therapies. Being opportunistic infection, zygomycosis is produced by contaminating fungi in which host? The host which has immunological defense mechanism weakened by endogenous causes, which causes like malignancies, leukemias, diabetes mellitus, exogenous causes like immunosuppressive therapies. Currently, in current pandemic, we are observing the patient which are treated with immunosuppressive therapies for the infection of COVID. Which are treated for the COVID caused by the SARS-CoV-2 virus. Neozygomycetes species are emerging like apophysomyces, elegans, subsanium, pessiformis. These are important causes of zygomycosis in number of patients involving various other organ systems. Predisposing factors. The agents of mucormycosis require iron as a growth factor, hence condition with increased iron load are at high risk of developing invasive mucormycosis. DKA, that is diabetic ketoacidosis, is a most important risk factor. Acidosis causes release of iron from the sequestered proteins in serum. End-stage renal disease, patients taking iron therapy such as deferoxamine, iron chelator, defects in phagocytic functions, for example, neutropenia or steroid therapy. New coronavirus SARS-CoV-2 itself may serve as a risk factor to patients suffering with chronic respiratory disease, corticosteroid therapy, intubation, mechanical ventilation, deranged glucose metabolism, which may lead to secondary fungal infection. Overall mortality, which is observed in case of pulmonary mucormycosis, 50 to 70%. Rhinocerebral, 30 to 70%. CNS involvement is more than 80%. Disseminated infections are seen in 90% of cases. In AIDS, almost 100% of cases. The risk developing this risk group peoples with weakened immune system at a higher risk acquiring mucormycosis. Factors predisposing to infection include conditions such as diabetes, severely immunocompromised individuals such as suffering with cancer or AIDS, or immunosuppression by use of steroids, other drugs that slows or stop the immune system process that triggers inflammation, as we have seen in case of COVID-19 treatment, hematological malignancies, hematopoietic stem cell transplantation, organ transplantation, intravenous drug administration, uses, neonatal prematurity, and malnourishment. Let's see the role of immunity. The neutrophils appear to play a major important role. The role in defense of the host from infection caused by pyroviruses. In normal host, macrophages prevent initiation of infection by phagocytosis or an oxidative killing of the spores. Host with diabetes mellitus and other underlying factors, and then monocytes, macrophages are dysfunctional and fail to suppress the spore germination process. These hosts with neutrophil defects, either qualitative or quantitative, are predisposed to infection by fungal agent of this class. So let's see the pathogenesis and pathology. Spores of fungi causing leukomycosis, they are ubiquitous in nature. Route of transmission, three routes of important routes of transmission: inhalation, traumatic inoculation, and ingestion. These spores are developed into mycelium plume containing white aseptic IP. These IP are angioinvasive in nature, that is, they can cause invasion and occlusion of small, medium-sized pulmonary arteries, resulting in spread of infection. So these are the routes of transmission. Susceptible host can acquire the infection through inhalation, ingestion, implantation, inoculation, through needle. They can suffer with rhino-orbital or rhino-cerebral mucormycosis, pulmonary mucormycosis, gastrointestinal mucormycosis, cutaneous disseminated amniocytes. These fungi, they are angioinvasive. They can spread through hematogenous dissemination and they can involve most of the organs. Mucormycetes or zygomycetes, they enter the body either by inhalation through airborne infection of spores or by precutaneous inoculation or by injection. Once the spores reach the lung or subcutaneous tissue, they are destroyed by the first line of defense, mononuclear and polynuclear phagocytes in healthy individuals. But when immunocompromised host breathes in spores of mucormycetes or zygomycetes, the defense system is hampered, and that can cause an infection commonly in the lungs or sinuses, which can spread to other organs, other body parts, and they can cause disseminated infection. So, first the fungal space get inhaled and they get trapped in the paranasal sinuses. Macrophages or polymorphonuclear lymphocytes, they block the replication impaired in neutropenic patients with the corticosteroids, monoclonal antibody therapies, or of graft versus host disease or hyperglycemia. Then these fungi, they go undetected and they proliferate. They are angioinvasive in nature, cause necrosis. With iron overload, this proliferation get enhanced. Progressing fungal invasion is seen and they can cause hemorrhage, necrosis, which can be detected by CT scan, extensive necrosis, and that again limits the drug delivery and immune response, and the disease will disseminate. So, inhaled sporangiospores reach to the distal alveolar sclerosis, where the mononuclear and polynuclear cells clear the spores and germ lines, but the fungal acquisition of free iron supports the growth and forms the hyperplasm. These hyphae, they become angioinvasive, they reach to the tissues, they can cause hemorrhage, thrombosis, and necrosis. Fungal growth overwhelms the host defense and disseminates via bloodstream or direct invasion of the contagious tissue. So, first case, inhaled into the lungs, they get ingested by the alveolar macrophages, inhibition of germination of spores, but this activity has limited process. In diabetic patients with ketoacidosis are disproportionately affected. Rhizopus species have an active ketone reductase system and they thrive in high glucose and acidic conditions. These patients also have decreased phagocytic activity due to the impaired Luta thai pathe. It's also seen that the patient who are on dialysis and iron overload therapy, such as deferoxamine or an iron chelator, are most susceptible to acquire infection of zygomycosis or mucormycosis. Other risk factors: neutropenia, high dose systemic steroids, protein calorie malnutrition, solid organ bone marrow transplant, immune deficiency, leukemia, IV drug abuse are the other risk factors. These patients may get injected spores of mucorrhiz with their drugs and then present with space occupying lesion in the central nervous system. Zygomycetes have predilection for elastic lamina of large and small arteries, causing thrombosis, hemorrhage, and infarction. Hence, angioinvasive thrombosis, ischemia, and tissue necrosis are primarily the histopathological features which are seen in zygomycosis. Diabetes and mucormycosis. So diabetes and zygomycosis impairs neutrophil function, causes chemotaxis, transmembrane migration, superoxide production. Then the nature of angioinvasion is a hallmark of mucormycosis that can enable mucorrhiz to disseminate through hematuria to enter the endothelial cells, which is mediated by GRP78, the expression of which is greatly enhanced when under the diabetic ketoacidosis and hyperglycemia conditions. Mucorrhiz internalization host is iron dependent, and there is increased iron level, acidic condition, diabetic ketoacidosis, due to which the reduced binding with transferrin. Mucormycosis and COVID-19, where the reduced CD4-CD8 lymphocyte ratio is there, neutropenia, inflammatory cytokine surge that can increase interleukin-6 ferritin levels, that induces chances of mucormycosis, diabetogenic state, endothelitis, prothrombotic state, use of immunosuppressive agents such as steroids, tocilizumab, and prolonged use of broad-spectrum antibiotics. These are the risk factors of developing mucormycosis in patients treated for COVID-19. Clinical features: zygomycosis can be divided into following six types of clinical categories on the basis of citing rhinocerebral zygomycosis, pulmonary zygomycosis, cutaneous zygomycosis, gastrointestinal zygomycosis, disseminated zygomycosis, and miscellaneous zygomycosis forms. So we'll start with rhinocerebral zygomycosis or rhinocerebral mucormycosis, ROCM. Common and fulminant type of zygomycosis lead to fatal complication within a week of onset of disease if left untreated. Invariably associated either with acute diabetes mellitus, hyperglycemia, ketoacidosis, or with debilitating diseases such as leukemia and lymphoma. And currently, the immunosuppressive therapy and COVID-19. This is most commonly spread from nasal mucosa to turbinate wounds, paranasal sinuses, orbit, and palate with extension into brain, where massive invasion of blood vessels causes major infarct. The destruction of bone is often revealed by CT scan. Several species of zygomycetes have been reported as the etiological agent. Majority of cases are due to rhizopus arisus. Symptoms include one-sided patient swelling, headache, nasal or sinus, congestion, fever. On physical examination, you can see brownish blood stain, nasal discharge on affected side, black discharge on palate, fixed and dilated pupils, global proptosis, vision threatening, and ptosis with dysfunction of cranial nerve, especially 5th and 7th nerve, extensive and rapid destruction of surrounding tissue. Sometimes they can spread to lungs, gastrointestinal tract, skin, and occasionally to organs. ROCM is usually fatal as patient dies within a week time and invariably diagnosed on autopsy. You see the pictures. Pulmonary zygomycosis or leukomycosis, the second most common form for inpatient with leukemia, now inpatient with COVID-19. Infection occurs through inhalation of spores, sporangiospores. Severely immunocompromised patients get affected by the virtue of an absolute lack of circulating neutrophils. Secondary to hematological malignancies, there are leukemia, lymphoma, peripheral immunosuppression, bone marrow transplantation. The lesions may be focal or diffuse and usually uncommon in patients having underlying diabetes mellitus in comparison with the rhinocerebral leukomycosis. Invasion of blood vessels may result in destruction of lung parenchyma. The usual course of the disease takes 1 to 4 weeks from onset to terminal stage of illness. The clinical manifestations are very non-specific and may include chest pain, dyspnea, hemoptysis, chest extremity, may show evidences of infiltration, usually involving an anatomical segment, but typically progressing to involve multiple adjoining areas at the same time. Rarely members of leukomycosis found to perform cavities similar to fungus wall with their radiological picture, as we have seen in aspergillum. You can see here the little chest extent. Symptoms may reveal lobar consolidation, isolation masses, nodular disease, cavities, or vase-shaped infarcts. It is difficult to differentiate between invasive aspergillosis and pulmonary leukomycosis. Both are similar, showing signs and symptoms which are similar, as even on radiological presentation, vascular invasion and thrombosis, followed by tissue necrosis, which can be seen in both the cases. A differential diagnosis for leukomycosis needs to be differentiated from pulmonary aspergillosis as quickly as possible because the treatment differs. Both the infection, the treatment are different. The presence of approximately 10 or more than 10 pulmonary nodules, pleural effusions, or concomitant sinusitis favors the diagnosis of leukomycosis. Next form is cutaneous zygomycosis or leukomycosis, which can be either primary or secondary to disseminated form, which is relatively benign. Primary cutaneous lesions are rarely reported due to direct inoculation into the skin, causative traumatic inoculation of fungal infection in the skin. Usually seen in patients with severe burn wound, superficial ulcer, in patients with diabetes mellitus, gangrenous cellulitis, patients, infections associated with contaminated elasticized wound dressings. The lesions which are developed are painful, progressively enlarging with nodular comosis, areas of cutaneous infarction. Necrotizing fasciitis can be seen secondary to cutaneous zygomycosis. Etiological lesions involve a rhizopressin mucus, which can occasionally cause cutaneous lesions. Treatment, prompt aggressive surgical debridement, and early institution of appropriate antifungal agent is very crucial. Next form is gastrointestinal zygomycosis or leukomycosis, rare, accounting about 7% of all cases of zygomycosis. Involved organ often is stomach, commonly seen in patients which are extremely malnourished and is believed to be acquired due to ingestion of food contaminated with fungal spores. Lesions in stomach are followed by colon, ileum, and esophagus. This may follow surgery to inflict the trauma to abdomen or contaminated intestine. Ulceration of gastric mucosa with thrombosis of associated vessels has been observed. Patients usually affected are adults, but also reported in newborns. It either colonizes or invade gastric mucosa. In invasive variant, involvement of vessel walls producing thrombosis, hemorrhage, necrosis, and ulceration of tissue seen could come as usually fatal. Sign symptoms, non-specific, abdominal pain, diarrhea, hemoptysis, marana, disseminated zygomycosis or leukomycosis. It is become widely disseminated, affecting lungs, kidney, gastrointestinal tract, heart, and brain. Lung being the most commonly involved site. Clinical syndrome, most frequently reported include pneumonia, stroke, subarachnoid hemorrhage, brain abscess, cellulitis, or gangrene of the skin structure. In addition, gastrointestinal bleeding, peritonitis, acute myocardial infarction, hepatitis, and superior vena cava syndrome seen related with zygomycosis. In cardiac patients, ultrastructural studies that reveals presence of thick wall fungus, which is participating in forming thrombus, crosses coronary arteries, and corkscrew pattern. Portal of entry in disseminated zygomycosis usually through traumatized skin, followed by invasion of blood vessels and dissemination of body organs. Etiological agents such as elegans, S. vasciformis, rhizopus species, these are the important one. Cerebral dissemination caused by hematogenous and lymphogenous CD by abscesses formation, particularly in intravenous drug abuses. In zygomycosis, aneurysm, numerous non-septate hyphae can be seen, obstructing cerebral arteries, perinephric abscess. This can be visualized in USG or CT scan. Next form is miscellaneous form, which can be seen as any body site can be randomly affected, as bones, trachea, or kidney, etc. can be affected in miscellaneous form. Laboratory diagnosis, specimens, clinical material from the affected area can be collected, nasal discharge sputum, which is rarely showing any fungal elements, deeper tissue section, serum for beta-glucan, direct examination, microscopic examination of nasal discharge, biopsy material, KOH weight mount that can reveal characteristic irregular, aseptic, ribbon-like hyphae with wide angle, right angle, branching at irregular intervals. The hyphae are sparsely and distributed in infected tissue. Therefore, spatial fungal stains are mandatory, such as HNV stain or Gomori's methanamine silver stain. This is the LPCB mount and this is the GIMSA stain. HNV stain showing the broad aseptic hyphae of infection. Histopathology, hypha will be seen, neutrophilic or granulomatous inflammation, absent in few cases, such as the cases which are immunosuppressed patient. Invasive disease is characterized by prominent infarct and angioinvasion. Perineural invasion may be present. Angioinvasion can extensive in neutropenia patient. Fungal culture, they can grow on STM, separate dextrozygote, with or without antibiotics at 25 to 30 and 37 degrees Celsius. Eucorals can grow on SDM, which is without actinium, that is cyclohexamine. The mycelial colonies are flocose, dense, and have hairy appearance. They are typically white cotton woolly colonies with tube filling growth. Which is known as lid lifters. Microscopic examination of culture confirms the cenocytic nature of hyphae and surrounding species. They can produce characteristic sporangia that can contain sporangial food. So here you can see mucus and the rhizopus culture, pictures of charcoal in our laboratory on institute. Some species of rhizopus species, they can produce brown black latter on due to the sporulation, giving rise to the picture, which is salt and paper appearance. You can see here microscopic appearance, LPCD of isopust. Colonies reveal broad aseptic hyphae, which are highly from sporangiospore. Okay. They arise and then ending at the sporangium. Here they can ending at the sporangium, which contain numerous sporangiospores. So rhizoids, some species we have many group like growth. This is many group like growth arising from the hyphae, called as rhizoids. These are the rhizoids which provides initial clue for identification of the fungus. Species can be differentiated on the basis of these rhizoids position respect to the sporangium. We have already discussed it. Rhizopus appears directly beneath the sporangiopore and the bears of nodal rhizoids. Lecthinia, they are absidia, the bears intranodular rhizoids, okay? Not directly beneath the sporangium. And mucor, they don't have any rhizoids absence. Immunodiagnostic methods, there are no satisfactory diagnostic tests available. For the final diagnosis, ELISA can be performed to detect antibodies which are produced in invasive type of infection. Antigen detection and specific T cell tests are available. Galactomannan and beta D-glucan serum specimen can detect these two. If negative, likely invasive mucormycosis than IPM. Mucoral specific T cells, this is the ELISA. Immunospot ELISA for detecting mucus-specific T cells. So, radio diagnosis, endobronchial lesions in diabetics, infrared waist-shaped consolidation, multiple nodules more than 10, cavitation, mycetoma, lobar collapse, and rarely pleural effusion. Allocence and air present signs. Molecular test, PCR, RFLP, DNA sequencing that targets the 18S ribosomal DNA of mucorals is available. Genus and species identification. There is no strong evidence that identification to the genus or species given will be important to guide the treatment. Better for epidemiological knowledge and investigation of outbreaks. Sequencing of internal transcribed spacer, ITS, of rRNA is the best technique for all these genus and species identification. Treatment, general principle, should be diagnosed early. Early administration of active antifungal agents, reversal of any kind of underlying factors, complete removal of all infected tissues, use of various actual therapies. Primary antifungal therapies that include liposomal, amphotericin B, which is the first line recommended agent. Fluconazole, variconazole are not reliable in their activity. Itraconazole can be used against absidia species. Fosoconazole, fluconazole, isotretinoin can also be used as first line therapy. Liposomal amphotericin B can be used as first line drug. Can be given 5 mg per kg per day to 10 mg per kg per day. CNS involvement is there. Surgery plus liposomal amphotericin B increase the survival rate and cure rate. Use of amphotericin deoxycholate is discouraged. ABNC can also be used if there is no CNS involvement. Alternate route, ABNC aerosolized with respired. Second nebulizer, direct installation of amphotericin B into pulmonary cavities or pleural spaces. Azoles, fosaconazole 800 mg per day in 2 or 4 divided doses can be used as first line drug, even as a salvage therapy. Isoconazole 200 mg OD, but vital study shows higher mortality rates and poor response. Duration of treatment, It is highly individualized. In near normalization of radiograph, negative biopsy specimens and cultures, recovery from the immunosuppression state depends on this, the duration of the treatment. Surgery, removal of necrotic tissues, increased nutrition of antifungal agents, lobectomy, pneumotomy, wedge restriction, surrounding infected. Healthy looking tissue should be removed. Crawl and metastasis mortality can be reduced by debridement up to 79%. If disease is refractory or intolerant, salvage therapy, if disease is refractory or intolerance towards previous antifungal therapy, you can use posaconazole, polyens plus posaconazole, lipid complex, liposome, colloidal depression, polyens plus capsofidine. Adjuvant therapies such as hyperbaric oxygen, 100% O2 at 2 atmospheric pressure for 90 minutes twice a day, cytokine therapy, and hematological malignancies, leukocyte transfusion plus interferon gamma, leostatin, taconazole, that is VT-1161, that inhibits fungal CYP15. So, steps to prevent mucormycosis: keep blood sugar under check, COVID or no COVID, use steroids judiciously while treating COVID, use clean water in humidifier used for O2 support, maintain overall cleanliness around patients. Any oral ulcer should be treated immediately. To summarize, mucormycosis, infectious agent, dimorphic fungi, humans appears ribbon-like, sinusitic, non-pigmented, broad, and irregularly branched hyphae. Most common cause of disease is rhizopus varicus. Epidemiology and risk groups worldwide: patient with neutropenia, patient with diabetes. Transmission, ingestion, inhalation, or contamination of wound with spores. Symptoms include rhinocerebral mucormycosis, shows acute invasive infection of nasal cavity causing necrosis and intense tissue destruction. Pulmonary mucormycosis, patients with neutropenia are particularly susceptible. Virulence factor, ketone reductase, causes fungal species to thrive in high glucose and acidic environments like ketoacidosis in diabetic patients. Treatment and prevention, surgical debridement and immune reconstitution. Amphotericin B, isavuconazole. Expected questions: mucormycosis, the black fungus, what is mucormycosis, habitat or order of mucormycosis, mucorales, etiological mucormycosis, virulence factor of mucorales, mode of transmission of mucormycosis, pathogenesis of mucormycosis, types of or forms of mucormycosis, laboratory diagnosis of mucormycosis, treatment of mucormycosis, prevention and control of mucormycosis, mucormycosis and COVID-19. So thank you, students. I hope you understand all the topic very well. If not, we are always there in the department and you can reach to us at any time. Kindly share your number in comment section, roll number, as you have attended the lecture. Thank you so much. Have a nice day.